right, what's up? You can see, you're not gonna say anything impressive. You're not gonna see. I'm just testing the waters, kind of a deal. Ooh, that was nice. That was talented on my part. There we go. I did it. I can do it. Oops. I'm hitting incorrect buttons. Oh, I done screwed up. That was supposed to kill. And then it kind of didn't. Would you stop being the randomest mother? Yes, I killed a slidehead. I'm the best. So I'm retrying Potemkin here, cause literally no other reason than his voice is godlike. His Japanese voice, everything he shouts, all of his move things, godlike, amazing, absolutely amazing. However, I will freely admit, I'm looking for a character that doesn't require effort, and that's not Potemkin. That's not Potemkin. Like, this is the first time I've sat down with this game since my last video. No joke, I am not shitting you here. I have been that busy. This is actually my first day. Sound start with slide. Oh yeah! Oops, I fucked up. Oops, I just tried to do a 360. I just did the half circle in the wrong fucking direction. Would you stop being a random little bitch? Oh, that didn't fucking work. Dude, seriously, what is this character? Did I just get unblockable? I feel like I just got unblockable and I just tried to do a Tager jump. Dude, so what the fuck just happened? What is this character? So I will freely admit, I really, really, yo, seriously, what is this character? Like, he beat me with that move. The AI just beat me with that one move. That does not feel good. It does not feel good. I need to be using, like, hang on, like, that, nope, not like that. Like, not like that either. Did this motherfucker just do that? Dude, seriously, he's beating me with his one fucking, like, is that an unblock? What is that? I need to take this character to something. I need to learn this character. Like, if I want to play this game, I have to learn this character. This character has absolutely nothing that, like, that I can see and that I can actually, like, analyze right now. Like, oh, okay, that is obviously a sweep. That is obviously an over something. I can't do any of that. I cannot cancel it. Fuck you, dog. I'm probably dead then. Fuck this. I don't know how to play Potemkin. I literally got to, like, I think I got through trial 32 of his, and I was like, hey, let's go play, right? Can you cancel out? Like, I'm hitting every button. There we go. So this game. I obviously do not have the time for fighting games anymore. That is becoming quite clear to me. Like, because fighting games, it's both a good thing and a bad thing. The way fighting games are set up. Fighting games are basically the one genre of game which require a significant time investment just to get your foot in the door. Not even to, like, hit the ground floor and be able to start, you know, moving up the ranks, walking up the stairs and start beating people up on your way, you know, doing your Rocky training montage and shit. No, you gotta sit in your room and do like 7 billion crunches before you're ready to begin your training montage to actually become good. That's fighting games in a nutshell. You have to put a lot of effort in before you can make it to the steps to start running up them. You know what I'm saying? I don't have that time anymore. Like, I can get by on BlazBlue with minimal amount of effort thanks to the time investment that I put into that game back when I did have time. And so, you know, I can still play Tager at a decent level. I can pick up characters in that game somewhat quickly because I understand the mechanics of the game. I understand my options. I understand everything about it. I know everything about it. I've played it enough to get to that level where I have a thorough understanding of everything the game has to offer, how characters fit into the game. I'm restarting from step one here. I don't know any of them. I mean, obviously, I could just... I should go back through... What is this? I should go back through all of this shit just to kind of, like, I mean, obviously, you know, stuff like this, all of these, I don't need. But when you get to stuff like... Okay, none of this. Aerial roll? I don't even fucking remember that. The fuck is aerial roll? See, like, Gunflame? That's a specific move to... Like, why are you putting a specific move to... Whatever. Anyway! So I guess all of those are just, like... Here we go! These are all the things I need to learn. The different Roman cancels. It just stuck in my head that YRC means yellow Roman cancel. That's how far behind I am with this game. That never even registered until right at this moment when I'm glancing through this list. But there's a bunch of things here. I don't know the difference. I don't know the nuances between these three. I believe this is like, you know, regular gold bursts where you burst when you're not in a combo. I don't actually know what it does for you though. I don't know if it just raises tension or what. And then blue burst is, you know, bursting out of a combo. But it's just, there's so much faultless defense. I don't understand entirely. I understand what it is. Like, it's a kind of pseudo push block, and you can also use it to stop your forward momentum. That's actually how Chip does his, vortex is the word I'm looking for. But there's so many things that just, you know, I don't understand. Like, just glancing through this list, there's probably around 20 things I don't know. I don't know what they mean. Granted, I don't know what any of these mean either, but I do know that those are all Souls-specific moves, so who gives a shit about Souls moves? Because I'm not using that character. But it's all just stuff that, like, I'm trying to learn a character without understanding the fundamentals of the game first. And that's not gonna go well. But either way, let's just go check this shit out. Let's just go to I'm not actually going to do any of this stuff because I've already done this previously. But when you're just looking at this character list, right? I just tried Potemkin again. The problem with Potemkin, he's... Well, number one, he's the worst character in the game. That's a problem right out the gate. That's gonna be a problem no matter who you are. Potemkin's not a good character. And so when you're playing a character that is not, you know, at least, you know, mid-tier or higher, the way you have to get by is to have just extremely strong fundamentals in the game you're playing, and then you beat players with those fundamentals. I don't have those. I don't have fundamentals with the game. You can't just mash out his Potemkin Buster. I don't think you can mash out his Potemkin Buster since it requires it's a half circle back forward move. So you can't really just, you know, do that in the middle of a block string because you have to hold forward. You're going to get hit if you do it at the wrong time. It's not like a 360 where you can kind of just mash it out. And then when you're in the middle, you know, it's taking those backwards motions. So it's kind of instant blocking for you while you're doing the 360. You can't really do that with Potemkin. And then he's just, his moves are all weird. None of them really fit well. Like, a lot of them are good individually. But the problem with it is that a lot of those individual hits don't lead to anything. And then there's just the fact that one of the biggest aspects of this character's game that you need to get down 100% is to use those moves. Are those little hearts at the end of his finger or those triangles? Because I know they have, like, when he does the move, I can't actually... this is my bad eyesight. They look more triangular than heart shape, or whatever. Anyway, moving right along, just analyzing this dude. One of the main things you need to is what's it called? Hammerfall, I think, is charge move, and you can press a button while he has his forward momentum to stop that move, so that the hit doesn't go through and you're not stuck in recovery. Because I believe I'm not 100% on this. I don't know frame data for this game, but I believe it's heavily punishable. On block, so you want to be using the cancel. But so, like, that's one of the main things that you need to do with this character. Learn your different chains and to sweep at various distances so you can get max damage, and then you use hammer fall and then hammer break to get right back in their face. That's one of the main things you really need to get used to doing. And he also has people a saying, as far as I'm aware, one of the hardest combos in the game in his hammer break loops. Like, so basically what you have to do is do... I mean, I guess I can take him in here real quick just so I can actually show you what the fuck I'm talking about. So he has this loop in the corner. I don't know how to initialize it. I don't know, like, I don't know anything about it. I just know that it exists and I've seen Fab do it. Where it uses this move, and then you can cancel that. See, the problem is, that move is forward plus kick. Oh, you can see, actually, my input's on the right side. It's forward plus kick to do that move. And so, you have to do the loop, you have to do forward plus kick, cancel it into hammer fall, which you just saw me try to do, which hammer fall is a charge move. Then you have to, am I doing? Like, you have to do that rapidly, and then you do another fort. And so, basically, you have to do that over and over. I think I've seen Fab do it, like, because it raises them up a little. Because you have to, you can't just do it on grounded opponents. It has to be on... Actually, let me... Well, no, there's no way that should work. Obviously. So, I don't know how... I have no idea how you would initialize it. I think, actually, the moment... The majority of the time I see him initialize it is off of Roman Cancel. But so you get them with a wall stick, and this move against an aerial opponent will wall stick them. And so you do that, you cancel into this shit, which I am obviously not doing. That was way too slow, and I didn't even get the cancel. So that is apparently one of the hardest combos in the game, as far as I have heard. And that's, like, vital if you want to be maximizing your potential with Potemkin, is to learn that fucking combo. I ain't got time to learn that shit. I don't want to learn the hardest goddamn combo in the game. Fuck that shit. But then, you know, just learning that charge and the cancel to be using that for forward momentum. Just, you know, the knowledge that you have to have about other characters in general to play footsies with Potemkin is just so much more than... I am willing to... It's so much more effort to learn all that shit than I am willing to put in. So that basically leaves... Milia. Now, oops, I don't want to actually go in there. Now, I don't actually want to learn her. I don't want to, like... Milia is the perfect character for me. Perfect. She's a glass cannon. She's not particularly difficult to use. She's perfect for me. But she's too easy. That's the problem. You know, you want to be teased a little bit. You want there to be a chance of, you know, failure. You want to feel like your charm and your suaveness got you in the door. You don't want it to be like, oh yeah, no, she's just a whore. She'll sleep with anybody. You just get one drink in her and she's done. And that's all you got to do. You just got to get one knockdown with Milia and it's smooth sailing from there. It's no goddamn problem. And she doesn't... She is the easy mode rushdown character of this game. Like... I would say if you want two characters that you can pick that are extremely strong for minimal effort, it's Milia and Sol. Those are the two that you would go for. And, like, I do like simple characters. Simple being that, you know, like, I can grasp their game plan in a quick moment. It may not be particularly strong, but it's not particularly bad. But at the very least, it requires, like, kind of thought on my part. It doesn't require executional difficulty, but it requires knowing your opponent, knowing your character's options, etc., etc. Like, Potemkin's the other extreme of that. Potemkin is 100% a character that is based upon what I'm talking about. Basically reading your opponent and beating them based off of those reads. But he's, you know, the opposite end of the spectrum. Whereas Milia is too easy to do those things. All you need is one read to get a knockdown, and then from then on, it's autopilot offense to the rescue. With Potemkin, it's, he has those options, but they're just not good options. I think that's actually one of the biggest things, watching Fab play a bunch of matches, which Fab is the only successful Potemkin that I'm aware of, and he's obviously the best Potemkin in the world, there's no question or doubt about that. I feel like players like that get away with so much more and make their character look so much better than they are because people are scared of who they are. They think, holy shit, I'm playing Fab. This motherfucker is the best Potemkin player in the world. And so they let him get away with things that nobody should be really getting away with, if that makes any kind of real sense. Whereas some random like me playing online with Potemkin, people are going to let me do that. People are going to mash out of setups. People are going to just do random shit. And I'm not going to get away with as much, which is going to make my character weaker by comparison. Because that's one of the main things that you have to do in a fighting game, is you have to instill that fear in somebody. You have to make them scared to do those things beforehand, and that's why, like, I kind of tend to be more successful in longer sets against people, because I tend to pick characters that, against new people anyway, is because I tend to pick characters like, for instance, Tager. Now, Azreal is the opposite of this. Azreal was an amazing character. Everybody was just scared of him out the door. Everybody was more scared than they should have been of him out the door. So that made me more successful in, like, quick 2 out of 3s or, you know, whatever I was playing. Versus a character like Tager or Potemkin, where people are like, oh, this character fucking sucks. I can just do whatever the fuck I want. And so early on, you kind of have to eat some things. You have to do some stupid things. And then you have to make them scared. You have to instill that fear before you can actually really start to go in on your game plan. And players like Fab, who already have a name for themselves, are already known, as one of the best Guilty Gear players around, they already have that out the door. That's why, you know, people talk about the Wong factor, like how he always comes back. It's because people are playing in a tournament setting, they're beating Justin Wong, who for a very long time was considered the best fighting game player in America, still is considered one of the best, obviously. And so you're sitting there thinking, holy shit, I'm about to beat Justin Wong. And then your mind goes off on that, you lose focus, and all of a sudden Justin Wong pulls off some brilliant fucking out of nowhere comeback on you. Because you were focusing on the fact that you were just about to win against Justin Wong. The name actually serves a huge factor in fighting games. And so when you come across somebody that you know is a good player, you kind of have to be like, okay, I have to play smarter against this dude. And you don't do anything stupid. But you have to kind of be stupid sometimes in fighting games. You just have to throw it out there and make him be like, hey, punish me for this. If you don't, I'ma just run roughshod all over you. You have to, you know, you have to make them respect you a little bit. You can't just be giving them all the respect. And that's one thing that characters like Tager or Potemkin are not good at in an online setting, because these people on the other end of the connection don't know who the fuck you are. They don't care who the fuck you are. They're just gonna go wild, and they're gonna make you prove that you can beat that wildness, because that's kind of an online setting kind of amplifies the effect. It amplifies kind of the quality of that kind of game style, where, like, you know, you're just playing somebody once and then they're gone. So playing somebody once, you really don't get much of a read on that person. I mean, obviously you can kind of get a little bit of a read, but if you're losing half your life to get that tiny bit of a read, like, that isn't conducive to winning in a one-on-one, in a one-match environment. And that's kind of what online is. And so Potemkin is by far a character that requires more effort than the majority of this cast. Milia, like I said, requires very little because she controls you. You can't do anything once she sets up her Oki. You have to respect it. And, you know, like, there's no getting around that. You can't just throw out a reversal because you're going to get hit before the reversal comes out. You can't throw out normals because it's a meaty setup. The meaty will counter hit you and then she gets a full combo. She is a character that forces respect. And that's what I don't want. You know, I don't want a character that basically does my thinking for me and allows me to just go into a flow chart of offense, of just doing, okay, I'll just do my TK overhead here, I'll do a low here, whatever. You know, it's too easy. It requires no real thought. So Chip is the middle ground here. Chip is the same thing. He's a glass cannon, very strong, but he still requires more effort than I am able to put into the game at this time. Like, I have his fucking thingy, his main B&B in the corner. I spent maybe like 20 minutes working on this combo when I have completed it once. It's oddly difficult. Because it requires, because, like, obviously the first part isn't, you know, you do whatever into, I don't even remember the inputs, is it? Okay, yeah, I did that right. Alright, cool. Asshole. See, I missed the Alpha Blade there. That's the biggest part, though, is doing the, oops. Oh, that still kind of worked. Is getting that part. See, like, I missed the Alpha Blade again. I don't understand why the fuck the Alpha Blade is missing. I honestly don't. Like I said, like, this is his main corner B&B. You bitch. So why the fuck is that miss? I don't understand that shit. But yeah, it's this part that's getting me the most. Trying to do Kabuki into his dust move. That's the one that's giving me the most fits. It's oddly difficult. It requires a lot of effort to get down. And that's effort that I'm perfectly honest, I'm not willing to expend at this point in time. Because it's like, I've already wasted 20 minutes of my life trying to do this one combo. One motherfucking combo. Why does that miss? I don't fucking get it. I hate everything. So like I said, like, that kind of shit right there, that's why I don't have time for fighting games anymore. I don't have time to sit down for 2 hours to grind that combo out, get it perfectly, and then never miss it again. I don't have that time. I want a character that I can learn quickly, hit the ground floor running. Have I actually done any of this character shit? I have not. I really do need to. Who else have I not? I think I've done everybody else, actually, except for him. Oh, I haven't really done Axel either, because he gives a shit about Axel. He's a zoning character. I know 100% I'm not going to enjoy a zoning character. Oh, I haven't done Soul, really? Okay. So I've done everybody but Soul, kind of Axel, and Benman. But yeah, so that leaves basically Ino is another character that I'm interested in. I was kind of interested in Slayer. Like, honestly, Slayer would probably fit my criteria, but he looks boring, too. That's my problem right now. I want a character that's simple, that has a complex game plan, but is simple execution, but that isn't also boring. That's my criteria for a character. And right now, too simple. Just a little bit not simple enough. I need to put more work into her to figure out she might be what she, you know, might actually be exactly what I'm looking for. I don't know. Too boring. Too hard. I did try him out too, but I didn't particularly like Sin. He was kind of boring too. I didn't like the fact that you have to sacrifice setups in order to eat. I think that's my main thing, is that like you have to make sure you're eating every single time. And it's whatever. So I'm kind of like, honestly, Eno's kind of like my last shot right now. I really don't have any other characters in this game that I'm particularly interested in. Like, the characters that I've given serious, just to give you kind of like an insight into what I have done in my very small amount of time trying to play this game looking for a proper character. I tried him out, like I said, I didn't particularly... like him in general, but then it was kind of, you know, the push over the top was the having to eat after every single, well, not after every combo, but in general, you want to ensure that you have, you're eating regularly. I didn't particularly like that. Like I said, too easy, just not interested. I actually tried out Kai, because he was the first character the first time I ever saw Guilty Gear, Kai and Testament were the first two that I was like, oh, I would like to try them. Kai, literally, because this is how superficial I am. The only reason I liked Kai and thought, hey, let's try this character out, is because he used lightning. And I like characters that use lightning. That's it. I like that shit. Testament, I liked him because he used the fucking scythe. That's it. That's all that it was. I like Testament because he used the scythe. So what the fuck? Those were the only two characters I was interested in. And so Mei, just, she's big, she's slow, she's cumbersome, she's weird. I don't like her. Chip is basically, if I had the time that I used to, if we transposed myself from like 2010 into the now, Chip would be the character that I would pick, and I would sit here in training mode, and I would learn the character, and I would learn the game, and everything would be hunky-dory, and there would be none of these complaints, none of these videos. You'd be seeing me blowing people up online by now, but that's not how it is. I have not, this is actually the very, I don't know if I mentioned this, this is the very first day since Christmas that I have actually had a full day off from work, and like I don't have anything on my plate. I can just sit back and relax and do what I want to do. It's the first day since Christmas, and before Christmas it was the Thursday before that, the week before Christmas, that I had a day off. So that's basically 3 weeks that I have had one day to myself, and this is the second day finally sitting down and getting my thoughts together and trying to figure out what the fuck I want to do, and I can't get my thoughts together. They're too jumbled. Her, I just don't like her. She's, yeah. She got bunny ears. Look at that. It's like, no, no, thank you. Zoner, don't give a shit. She's basically my best shot right now. Boring. Too hard. Like, he's actually a character that I might be interested in, were he not like a mostly charged character, but then he's also got some motion shit, and he's got weird setup. Like, he is actually, I'll be perfectly honest, he's exactly the same as Chip. Actually, if I had the time to sit down and understand this dude's game plan and actually work with him, I really think I would have fun with Venom. I really do. Zato is just, he's far too fucking hard. And plus, he is a rushdown character, but he's far more based upon just having like a significantly superior neutral game to everybody else. And that also is something that doesn't really interest me, is having a character that is just so significantly better than the rest of the cast. I don't really like that. It's why, it's one of the reasons why I would never pick Kokonoe. I mean, besides all the other reasons that I hate Kokonoe, but just the fact of how strong she is and how much less effort it requires to actually beat people, it doesn't feel good to me. You know, I'm not that enamored with the competitive aspect of... It's exactly the opposite. I am so enamored with the competitive aspect of fighting games that I don't want to use a character that kind of shits on that. That, you know, like, Kazato, to me, is basically the kind of character where it's like, he requires a ton of effort to get to his optimal level, but he rewards it so strongly that he is by far the best character in the game, and that just doesn't interest me. I want a character that, you know, does have some challenges here and there. And Bedman's just, no thank you. I'm not, nah, that dude's fucking weird. He ain't even wearing no damn pants. Wear some fucking pants, dog. God damn. And I have seen Leo, but I will never support Arc System Works DLC again. Like, it's $8 for a character is absolute bullshit to me. I will never support that. You will never see me buying that again. I bought Valkenhayn. He was the one DLC character I ever bought. And we all know how much that money went to good use. But still, it's just, you know, I'm not... $8 is too much for a character. It's stupid. You know, like, I'm buying... This game cost me $50. It was $49.99. No, actually, this game did not cost me anything. I forgot. I haven't actually bought it yet. I just have it from Gamefly. So, actually, let me see. Because the next game that I have from Gamefly... That I have on my Gamefly queue doesn't come out until February. So, I don't have to worry about sending this back. But if I bought this right now... For me, personally... This game would cost me $40. Now, this is a brand new game. I got this on the on release day. So this, to me, is a brand new game. And Gamefly is absolutely amazing. They keep their cases and shit in tip-top shape. In absolutely amazing shape. So, like, even if it's a game that's 3 years old and you buy a game from them, they're going to ship you the original case. They're gonna It's going to have the manual. It even has those fucking... I think, actually, Nintendo's the only one that still does this. But they even have those fucking safety manual things that nobody reads ever still in them. Gamefly is a quality fucking company, I gotta say. Like, I've never really dealt with a company that's been this consistently great. And it's so understated, too. Like, nobody ever really talks about it. Like, man, Gamefly is awesome, but man, Gamefly is awesome! They're amazing, but so, let's just pretend I do not have this game from Gamefly. Let us pretend that I went out and I bought this game from somewhere, Amazon, GameStop, Walmart, wherever the fuck you want to go for your games, and I bought this at full price at $50. You are going to tell me that Leo is worth spending 1/8 of this game's budget on? 1/8, not this game's budget, but 1/8 of my budget that I spent on this game, and you're going to tell me Leo is worth 1/8 of that? Uh-uh. You can go fuck yourself. Like, DLC is such a divisive thing in gaming right now. And to put out a character, one character for $8, like, do you remember how much shit Capcom got for releasing their DLC characters? Like, now granted, a lot of that just had to do with most of them being on the disc. I don't know if all of them were on the disc or just most of them. I remember Blanca and Elena were both still on the disc, but I don't know if every single one of them had their full data on the disc or not. But either way, that was a large portion of the complaints, and you know, you gotta give that a little bit of a shout out. But just the fact that they did have character DLC received so much complaint and controversy and just general bitching. You know how much that shit cost? $20 for 12 characters. That's less than $1 a character. No, less than $1 a character. That's just a tiny bit over. Not a tiny bit over. A tiny bit under. My mathematical brain right now is working amazingly. This is scaring me. Because I'm taking calculus next semester. And my math brain... Like, I'm good at math. I'm not going to front on that. I have always been particularly decent at math. Now, I'm not, you know, some fucking amazing genius. But it's just not something that's ever been particularly difficult to me. But it is clear that it has been so long since I have stretched the part of my brain that actually handles math. That I'm not as quick at it as I once was, and damn, it's embarrassing. A little bit under $2 a character, and they received so much shit for that. And yet, you know, like, a lot of people are like, oh, hey, look at that, Arc System Works DLC character. Not that, you know, obviously the fact that he is $8 hasn't met its own level of criticism. But so many people are just like, yo, dude, it's DLC. Just support the game, bitch. For $8 for a character? How you feel about Capcom? Oh, Capcom is ripping they fans off, dog. They're a shit company. Oh, yeah, okay. Sure thing, bro. If there's one thing that universally in the world I can't stand is hypocritical people. It's people that will shit on something because they just don't particularly like, sometimes it's just because the games are more popular. But that's just a factor of popularity. That's something that happens. If something is more popular, it's going to draw more criticism because it has more time in the public eye. It gives more people an opportunity to know about it and see it. And so it's going to be met with more criticism. That's just a realism of popularity. But Capcom receives so much unnecessary shit from people that I see immediately turn around and do stuff like support Arc System Works DLC policies. Like, man, I love Arc System Works. I'll buy everything they put out. Oh, Capcom is the worst fucking company in the world. They ripping their fans off with all their DLC, man. It's ridiculous. They should be crucified. I'm like, what?
Huh? How do you vote? You're fucking stupid. How do you do that?
But I actually remembered a story that I'm going to tell real quick, and I promise I'm going to wrap this up shortly. Just to discuss how people see me in the world. So, like I said, I work, I am a vendor for a for an outside company, and basically what I do with my time, as my job, I go into various stores, such as, you know, local grocery store chains, bigger, you know, more noticeable chains, shit like Walmart. I don't know how widespread Winco is, but Winco's kind of similar to Costco-ish, if Costco didn't sell any of, like, their, I mean, Winco's just a grocery store chain. That's all that it is. It's only grocery stuff. It doesn't have all the, you know, electronics, all the other, you know, random stuff that Costco also carries. It's only for groceries, but it's spreading quite a bit in California. I don't know how widespread it is, but it's definitely one of the best grocery store companies in the world that I'm aware of. They treat their employees incredibly well. I'm going off on a tangent here. But seriously, man, it blows my mind how many people still support Walmart when you have a place like Winco. I mean, granted, the reason why is because Walmart carries such a diverse set of products, whereas, like I said, Winco is just for groceries. But it's just Winco has similar, if not lower, prices than Walmart, but they treat their employees incredibly well. They don't, you know, pay their employees shit and give them shit benefits in the hopes of having $1 billion more profit a year. That kind of shit. But we're going off on too far of a tangent now. That's what I do. I go into stores and I stock the shelves with my company's product. It's my responsibility to ensure that the shelves are full, look good, etc., etc. And so I was, over the holiday season, I saw a lot more people than I am used to seeing. And so, you know, one of the things that you have to do is with the driver has to check in all of their product. The driver has to, ensure that what the paperwork, the company, that the store is getting matches the delivery stuff. All the numbers match up. They're getting the proper amount of product. Nothing's been left off. Nothing's been, you know, they're not, basically no scams are going on. It's just a realistic, you know, something you got to deal with. And so this motherfucker couldn't figure out what 18 times 3 was. So he looks at me and goes, hey, what's 18 times 3? That's 54. It's not exactly the most complicated math formula you've ever heard in your life. And he looks at me and goes like, that was quick. Are you sure? Yeah, I don't think. And then the receiver, the person that's checking, is like, I don't think that's right. We should double check that. Like, motherfucker, it's 18 times 3. How are you? Come on, man. All right, fine. No, you do you. I'm going to go walk over here and you can handle. It was in a Walmart, if that explains things in further detail. But still, it's just like, are you fucking serious? You're questioning me on 18 times 3? Come on, man! Like, that doesn't instill confidence on my abilities? Shit! But, anyway, I have some soul-searching to do. Now, I'll be perfectly honest. There has been no, like, spark that has occurred in this game that's made me be like, oh my god, I love this! I want to play this! Now, granted, that has not really existed in games of late. Like I said, the only reason why I'm really getting by in BlazBlue in general is because of my previous experience with BlazBlue. is because I enjoyed CS so much and put so much time into it, that I am able to basically lean on that previous experience and get by just fine. I will never be as dedicated. I don't have the time to be as dedicated as I was back then, but just the fact that I'm growing as a general fighting game player makes it so that I can get by with what I learned back then, and then I can just, you know, pick up who I want to play and just play them. I can't do that in a game like this. This is new territory for me. I'm lost. I don't have a map. I don't know what I'm doing, and nothing has really clicked for me. I haven't had that moment where it's just like, yes, this is perfect. This is what I want to be doing. And that's kind of what you need in a game, you know, in a game that requires as much dedication and effort as fighting games do. You need to have that one character, at least that one character, that you just play and you're like, damn, this makes me want to continue playing the game. And I haven't run into that in Guilty Gear yet. It's also one of the main things, like, the only reason I even played BlazBlue, I think, in Chrono Phantasma as much as I did is because Asriel clicked like that for me. No other character really did that. Like, sure, I kind of enjoyed Tager. Sure, I kind of enjoyed Bullet. But if Asriel wasn't there, I would never have played it as much as I did. And, you know, just not having that little click, not having that spark of inspiration of wanting to become better with that character means that you're not going to be putting as much effort. You're not going to care as much in the game. And, you know, like I said, with fighting games, the amount of effort they require, you have to care. I can't just be trying to play this out of, like, a sense of, hey, I want to get my fans videos, and they're interested in this shit, so let's play it to give them videos. That's not enough of a motivation for me. Because obviously I'm not making money off of this. I'm not rolling in millions of dollars at the bank, be thanks to my YouTube views and videos and stuff, so there's no monetary motivation there for me. It's just literally doing this because I enjoy doing it. And so if I don't enjoy the game I'm doing it with, please don't make any sort of innuendo comments about this. I get that it's all there. I understand that. Please just leave it alone. Please just let me go through it and make an embarrassment of myself and just let it slide. There's just not enough motivation for me to stick with something that I don't enjoy. And that's what Persona 4 Arena was. But at the very least, at least Persona 4 Arena had an easy character that I could play and get by in general with Sho. And it was the same thing with Ken, too. There's a bunch of characters in that game that you can just pick up and play. You know, criticize Persona 4 Arena as much as you want. Obviously, I've fucking done it. But the one thing they do have, in general, is the simplicity of character selection. Where nothing they have really requires sitting in training mode for just hours upon hours and just grinding away your time to learn one aspect of the game. And that's where, you know, the accessibility versus execution argument comes in. How much effort should somebody have to expend just to be able to play a character at a basic level to where they don't just get smashed because they don't have the executional properties necessary to play their character of choice? And that's a big point of controversy so far in this game, is that, you know, a lot of people feel like it's too watered down, but I very, very strongly believe that you can make a game's mechanics, the overall, like, you know, neutral game, offense versus defense, the whole chess match involved in that whole thing, complicated and deep and interesting without having to make the character so difficult to learn that it's like, man, I've spent like 20 hours learning this character. Let's actually start playing the game now. That's what gets me. Like, I will never spend that much effort to learn a character. It doesn't interest me. That's not why I play fighting games. I've mentioned before, like, if I go sit in training mode, I can be in training mode for maybe 5 or 10 minutes. I'm like, I'm bored. I want to go do something else. That's what happened with me with Chip. I sat in training mode with him trying to do that combo for, like, 10 minutes and just kept screwing up. I didn't really understand why. It was very odd why it was screwing up. You know, you would think that I understand having, like, one difficult link in a combo. That's perfectly fine. So, the timing on his dust after doing his whole, you know, kabuki flip shit, whatever the hell it's called, having the timing be a little bit awkward on that is perfectly fine. You gotta learn that timing, but once you get that timing down, everything flows smooth as butter. But you saw me fail entirely the few times that I did hit the dust attack to land the Alpha Blade afterwards. That makes no fucking sense. So, like, in rapid succession, there's three things that I am continually dropping. And that two of them I don't really understand particularly why. So, like, for that motion, just to describe to you, if you don't understand shit, what you have to do is you land that dust attack, and then you do Alpha Blade, and after you hit the Alpha Blade, you have to do a very rapid, is it 6-4, or is it 4-6? I believe it's 4-6. A very rapid 4-6 motion to land on the wall, to do a wall cling, and then you hit, I believe it's Kick Again. Is it Kick Again? I don't know, It's kick. Nah. I don't even know. You have to hit a button to do the other Alpha Blade to give you the knockdown. Or, alternatively, if you're looking for damage without the Oki, you would then want to release the wall by holding whatever direction is opposite the wall. So if you're on the right side of the screen, you would hit 4 and he would release the wall. If you're on the left side of the screen, you hit 6 and he would release off the wall. And then you gotta hit buttons very rapidly to get an aerial combo off that character. And it's just, all three of those things are things that I have been screwing up and that require effort to get down. And again, it's a matter of, is this game worth spending that much time to get one B&B down? Not, you know, it's not like, oh, once I get this combo chain down, I'm good to go with this character. That's one combo out of like 15 you gotta know for various hit confirms with Chip. And it's just, you know, it becomes that argument of, do I have the time necessary to actually learn this? Do I want to bother expending that time, or can I spend it better elsewhere? And that's the biggest thing about fighting games. You know, a lot of people that started in 2009 with Street Fighter were people that were either, you know, teenagers or people that were in college that had a lot of free time thanks to, you know, the status of their life. But now, you know, they're growing up, they're getting jobs. School's getting more difficult. You know, now they moved from the general education easy mode classes to the mastery level classes, which require a lot of time and effort to get down. There's less time to spend on fighting games, and it's just, you know, it's that argument that I am a very clear example of. Is it worth having such a large executional barrier to play a game, or should it be watered down somewhat? And should you try to find that perfect balance of accessibility of characters with depth of game mechanics? And that's something that I feel like this game doesn't really hit very well. It's very all over the place. Some characters are extremely easy to learn and utilize. I would say Kai and Soul as characters are very easy to pick up and utilize. Kai a little bit more, less so, because he's very neutral footsie based, and so getting the mentality around that requires effort, but at least that's effort that you spend in actual matches learning how to play the game properly. Versus, like I'm saying, like right now with Potemkin or with Chip, or if I picked up Ramlethal or Venom, I would be spending time, so many hours of my life, in training mode, just learning combos so I don't drop them in the middle of matches. And that's not worth it for me. Like, absolutely not. I could be using my time so much better in so many other ways. And so, you know, like I said, it becomes that argument of, is it worth doing this? And for me, so far, it hasn't been. So after all of that, I hope that properly explains why you have not been seeing tons of Guilty Gear videos. I gotta put some effort in. Unfortunately, I put my day's effort, the time that I had today to play into Potemkin to, you know, kind of solidify those previous, you know, it was kind of like, I think this is how it's gonna be, but you know what, let's just try it, let's just see what the fuck happens. And it is kind of like that. I honestly believe if I just got over the awkwardness of a lot of his pokes, I might be able to get into him. But I will never be able to use him at, like, a successful level, because I will never put in the time to learn his hammer break loops. And those are so necessary for him. Plus, a lot of the stuff, like, a lot of what he does requires a lot of option selecting. That's a whole nother argument. I'm not going to get into it. This video's gone on long enough anyway. So I hope that explains my current predicament, explains what's going on with this video, and I'll try... If nothing clicks for me, then I will just go online with Potemkin and just mash against people and just see what the fuck happens and see if I can have fun just kind of screwing around versus trying to take it seriously and actually trying to be, like, competitive with it. But we'll see. I gotta put some effort into Eno. It's kind of just been, like, a tickle at the back of my mind this entire time that, like, I honestly think Eno is going to be the character that I should be trying to put effort into. But, you know, it's just... eh, let's try this other character first. Try this other character first. So if Eno does end up being the perfect fit, I'm going to end up smacking myself around for being a damn tool and wasting all that time. But anyway, thank you for listening, because there wasn't much watching going on there. And I will see you next time.